I find the whole thing fascinating because of just how many layers there are that keep coming out about this. The contents now of the cockpit voice recorder from the Lion Air crash back in October are now being made public for the first time, and it reveals just how much the pilot and co-pilot on that flight fought to regain control over the plane. And this is all happening as the Seattle Times reports the FBI is now joining the criminal investigation into how the Boeing 737 MAX was certified to fly. The federal grand jury investigation started in response to the October crash, but has renewed purpose now in the wake of a second MAX crash last week with Ethiopian Air. And you may have heard a lot of talk about pilot training in relation to a new system that wasn't on previous models of the 737. I had a chance to talk to NBC's Tom Costello, who's been covering this story nationally. I am no engineer, but I think I know that it sounds concerning when we talk about the fact that computers and machines can override certain systems on an airplane, and it's impossible in some of these cases for the humans to regain control over it. Should we be looking into what we give to the computers to handle versus what the pilots are actually able to take control over?
I think traditional Boeing pilots would say yes, that absolutely is a concern. There's kind of a difference of philosophy between the Boeing, the way the Boeing has designed aircraft for the last 30, 40, 50 years, and Airbus. Boeing has always believed that the pilot should have the final say, that the pilot has the best feel for his or her plane, and they need to have the final determination on what to do. Airbus has believed we want to make a plane that is so fully automated and has so many protections built into it that it becomes very, very difficult for a pilot to crash that plane, and that we're going to make it almost idiot-proof, that there are literally envelopes that you can fly in if you're on the Airbus. If you violate an envelope, then the computer brings you back inside the normal flight plan. So Boeing was in some ways trying to adhere to the Airbus philosophy. That's kind of what MCAS was all about, providing the same kind of protections to a Boeing 737 that are common on an Airbus plane. Airbus stands by that and says, listen, these protections have served us well for a very long time, and we have to remember that we're not just building airplanes for frontline pilots out of the U.S. and Canada and Europe, but also people in other parts of the world who may not benefit from the same level of pilot training, and that's why they believe in automation. Boeing tried to adhere to some of that, and now they're paying the price.
Gosh, it is fascinating. I mean, this whole, you know, man versus machine and what happened in this case. I know there have been some new reports about the flight right before the Lion Air crash. What did he say about that?
I thought that was, I mean, it's stunning to me because they still don't know why the communication didn't get passed along. But on that same aircraft, that same Lion Air aircraft that ended up crashing, the flight previous to that, that crew reported the same issue, was struggling with the controls. The reason we are now hearing that they were able to regain control is that there happened to be a third pilot riding deadhead in the cockpit. So he wasn't there to fly the plane, he was just flying back, and he was able to stand up and regain control and figure it out. But that apparently, and they're still looking into this, that was not communicated to the flight crew of the doomed flight that happened right after that.
And then I heard, I read or heard somewhere that as that plane was going down, they were literally scrambling, going through the manuals.
Yes.
Trying to figure out what to do.
They have manuals specific to the cockpit where you can, I think they're called quick reads or something like that. And they were frantically going through it. And I saw one expert equate it to, it's like having a checklist of 100 items and you're going through as many of them as possible and you just get to number 75. You don't get to 100 in the amount of time that you need to fix the problem. And this is just the beginning. He says he doesn't imagine that the 737 MAXs could get back up in the air for months.
Right. I mean, how could
they? I know. Yeah. So we'll definitely continue to follow it.
Are pilots talking a lot about this in
pilots,
the forums?
A lot of pilots are saying that, look, if this had happened in North America, the plane would have landed safely because we're trained properly on that. But other pilots are saying, I don't want to fly a MAX until I can get back in a simulator. There is only one simulator for the 737 MAX 8, and it's in Florida.
There was one for the older version?
I don't know about the old 737, but as far as learning how to fly this new version, there is only one simulator. So we don't know if they're going to insist on having time on that simulator before flying the plane. There are still so many unknowns, and that was one thing I learned in talking with Tom Costello there, is that they don't know if there are mutually exclusive things happening or if there were a series of things that all went wrong for both of these crashes to happen.
Okay. Well, Casey, thank you. And